My name is Mark. Welcome to Power Your Story, a podcast from Wakefield Training Center High School in Chicago.
This season, our theme is called My Favorite Things. It's all about how to use the things we love to help us relieve stress and anxiety so we can live happier lives. In this episode, we are interviewing Ian Chadwick, a nature educator who works at Joshua Tree National Park in California.
We talk about one of my favorite things, nature.
Enjoy this episode.
Welcome, Alan. Introduce yourself and tell who wills about the work you do.
Okay. So my name is Ian Chadwick. I am a ranger at Joshua Tree National Park, and Joshua Tree is located in the California desert. I work as what we call an interpretive ranger. So an interpretive ranger is a ranger that is the one that works out with the public. So I run programs talking about the different plants and animals and things that you would find at the national park, as well as help people get an idea of what they might expect to see when they're exploring the park and what they need to do to just be prepared. I started it after living and working in Chicago for about 5 years at various institutions like the Garfield Park Conservatory and the Lincoln Park Zoo. But now out here in the beautiful California weather, really enjoying my time with millions of visitors right now.
Hi, my name is Joel. Why did you get into this line of work?
That is a really important question because a lot of people do it for different reasons. And I think the really big reason that I wanted to do it is because growing up, actually, even in Wisconsin, was considered more of a city boy. I grew up just outside of Milwaukee, and most of my dad's family and my mother's family all lived in semi-rural areas, much more country than where I was from. I commonly thought that I was never really as outdoorsy as any of them were. And while I did do lots of hiking and fishing and things like that, I moved away from that thinking that nature wasn't necessarily for me. In the long term, though, as I started my career in education, I started realizing that what connected me to nature was different than other people before. And I realized that all of us have different ways that we're connected to nature, what we appreciate about it, what we enjoy spending our time doing out in nature. And I do this line of work now because I'm interested in helping people find that connection, find the way that they can enjoy nature on their terms and make meaningful connections with the natural world around them. Essentially, I want to make nature accessible to everyone.
How can nature be a stress reliever?
Yeah, so that's a very important type of research that we're seeing a lot now. One of the most important ways that I think comes to mind can actually be found by research that is put out and helped by the American Heart Association. They talk about how during our regular day, everyday lives, we are constantly experiencing new, fast things coming at us. Things move very, very quickly. In nature, we're presented more with scenes that are slower. Instead of like a quick attention grabber, you have things that gently capture your attention. As you walk up to a tree, you slowly get to process everything about it as you make that move. This, instead of frazzling you like all the million things that can quickly happen on your phone or all the cars and quick commotion all around us, instead, it's a way of calming our nerves. So it can really bring us peace and slow down our brains, actually, in a way that is better for ourselves mentally. Quickly, another one I do want to always talk about is that nature is important in creating belonging. I think we can sort of all agree that we all want to belong. We want a group, or we want somewhere that we can see as our own. And it's been shown that nature can really foster this sense of belonging, even if you may feel lost in other parts of the world, maybe feeling down on your luck with friends or family or a variety of things. Nature is a good way to feel connected. And experiencing that, whether it be through a walk, sitting outdoors for a bit, is really important for helping with things like depression and anxiety.
What's your favorite part about nature?
My favorite part about nature is the feeling of community. Community, to me, is such an important thing. I feel like sometimes I've jumped between different communities throughout my life. Not sure if I've been in the right friend group every time or things like that, in the right job. But my favorite thing about nature is when I go out for a hike or when I simply sit outside in my backyard and watch the birds I set out bird feeders for. I feel like I have friends and neighbors around me. It is really calming. And I think that even just sitting outside in a beautiful scenery like that is without a doubt one of the best things ever.
What sparked your love for nature?
I was really privileged and lucky to experience nature from a very young age. And as I grew up, I had all these nature experiences. And, you know, I had many other things I was interested in, video games, sports. And I'm a big Packers fan. Sorry for all you Chicago Bears fans out there. But as much as I love Chicago and all of its green spaces, the big spark for me was recognizing that I wanted somewhere that I could really see and experience the natural world on a daily basis. At first, I thought Chicago wasn't that kind of place, but the more I realized it and the more I realized my love for nature, it was just the simple little sparks of the changing of the leaves in the fall and all the oak trees on the streets of Chicago, or seeing the birds and other animals that moved around living near the houses, or even just being by the lakefront. You know, those are really important. And every single little thing that I experienced in the natural areas by Chicago were just little sparks making me go, holy cow, nature is just wonderful and it is all around us. And I can't believe I didn't realize that for so long.
Do you walk with any animals?
So we have some very interesting animals out here in Joshua Tree in the California desert. Most of what I focus on is with an animal we all know, obviously humans. I focus on the human interactions with animals, but the park itself focuses on a few different animals, mainly that it's researching. Some of the most important ones are desert tortoise. So those are an endangered species in parts of the California desert, and we do a lot to track their movements and their population numbers to ensure that they're healthy. Same with bighorn sheep. Bighorn sheep, we have a few of those that live out here in the desert, although in the park we maybe have about 300. So we are keeping really good track of how healthy they are and what their numbers look like as well. But it also, we keep track of their predators, like mountain lions. Mountain lions are all over California, and you probably can find really interesting news stories about the California mountain lions that are living and trying to find a home here. We have maybe about, I would say, 10 to 15 in the whole park. But in the past, while I don't work as much in the research anymore, I also worked with a varieties of reptiles, small mammals like armadillos, and even when I was really lucky at Lincoln Park Zoo, I was able to work with our penguins there. I helped give tours and experiences for those who were interested in getting to go behind the scenes with some of the African penguins that Lincoln Park Zoo have.
What are some of your favorite animals to work with?
Honestly, hands down, favorite animal type would be reptiles. Snakes, lizards, tortoise. I love reptiles just simply because they're so misunderstood. They're so often feared. Like, people are really scared of snakes. I have not ever worked somewhere where people come up to me in a visitor center and go, where are the snakes? Where do I not need to go? I do not want to be by any snakes ever. I'm like, okay, well, let's first get a better idea of what reptiles are actually like. They are amazing creatures who are so well adapted to their environment, and we're so afraid of them because they get a bad rep. Their reputation suffers from being, you know, predators like rattlesnakes, but really they have no desire to harm us. And actually, as different snakes or reptiles get more acquainted with humans, they're actually pretty easy to handle. Lincoln Park Zoo handled a lot of reptiles and really tried to get kids to recognize that they aren't dangerous and they actually are very interesting. plenty of places around Chicago are doing a really good job at trying to change the way that we look at reptiles. I actually was also a member of the Chicago Herpetological Society, and they do some really awesome things with their junior herpetological club for anyone young who wants to learn and be around reptiles. So that is by far my favorite animal to work with.
What are your favorite plants?
This was the hardest question. I looked at the questions you guys sent ahead of time, and this one is so hard. So I'm going to have to pick two. One would be the oak tree, mainly because we see it all over the Midwest in Wisconsin and Illinois. And my favorite thing are these, what we call oak savannas. It's these big open prairie or grasslands that have just these big oaks standing in the middle, like almost all alone. And those oaks are so powerful. They really stand out, and they're able to survive because they can actually survive the fire that is so common on these prairie areas. I have some really favorite oaks, if that sounds sort of nerdy to say, by Jackson Park on some of the prairie areas down by Hyde Park and Jackson Park area. And also at the Garfield Park Conservatory, there's some really good oaks on the restored prairie areas there. But second place, or even a tie for first, would also be cactus. What makes them special is they just make us question what we think we know about plants, right? So we usually think, oh, the leaves on a plant are green, and that's how they get their sunlight and how they make food. Well, actually, think about if you are a cactus, your leaves are now actually spines that help protect you. And now your body of your plant or your stem is green, and you make your food and collect sunlight that way. It's just so different to think about that it really is so unique and beautiful. It puts them up there and definitely some of my favorite plants.
I can help you when you feel stressed out.
So the most thing that I think of is something that a few authors have been working with. It's called nature deficit disorder. It sounds medical, but really it's just the idea that we are starting to lose our connection with nature. And the more that we lose our connection with nature, the more stressed we feel. When we are constantly interacting with so many things outside of the natural world, things start to happen in our brains where we lose our sense of calmness. One of the best ones I can think of is simply how we sleep and how good of sleep we get every night. So you never wake up, obviously, and be like, wow, I slept forever, but I'm still tired. This is horrible. That's usually your brain saying that something's wrong with its rhythms, and it's trying to figure out how to rest. And nature is really good. If you follow sort of those day and night cycles out in nature, even just a few days of camping, or really trying to, okay, it's dark outside, I'm going to stop looking at my computer or my phone. It can really help to reset your brain and help you get really good rest. That way you sleep well. And obviously, I think a lot of us realize that good sleep is really important to losing that stress. And the more we follow those natural cycles of day and night, you can really break down that stress and eliminate it. I have a favorite author, Robin Wall Kimmerer. She's a Native American botanist and scientist who says that it's not just the land that is broken, but more importantly, our relationship to the land. The land is trying to recover from how we interact with it or live in it, but also how we are connected to it is different. We no longer follow its cycles, and we no longer follow the same night and day or the same style of life. And I think that really does need to change.
My name is Al, and do you specialize in plants and settle animals?
So I specialize in the animals of humans. So making sure that we are connected to other animals. So making sure that we learn about animals and feel like they are just like us, because they are. We are really animals. But the one thing that I also am working on is actually an interesting field of what we call restoration. And this idea is looking at not just singularly or just alone plants, insects, or animals, but actually the field or specialty in all of them and what they make all together. We would call it like a community or a landscape. Common one is an ecosystem. We've probably heard that back since like third grade, maybe. Teachers try to get us to learn that one. But the idea is that sometimes we need to specialize in just a whole ecosystem, like the Chicago grasslands or the Wisconsin woods, and learn on how that whole ecosystem works and figuring out what we can do to make it healthy. I still actually go to school as well, and that's something that I'm working on learning about, not just single plants, animals, or insects, but how all the plants, all the animals, and all the insects work together and what makes that healthy.
What is the most challenging part of your job?
Well, it is pretty tough. The big one for where I currently work at Joshua Tree is that about 3 million visitors come visit our park every single year. And it can be very overwhelming. You meet a new person every few minutes. And it's important but tough to remember that every single person that you meet who comes into the park is different. They're unique. They're an individual. And they are visiting for their own reason. They might not appreciate nature or love nature or why I love it, but they still are out there. The big challenge obviously comes on, it's the day after Thanksgiving. Black Friday is one of our busiest days of the entire year. And we get swamped by questions and people, and most of their coworkers or people get really stressed out. They're like, there's just so many people. But I like to think these people are all still out here visiting. They could be standing in line at Best Buy for a TV right now, but instead they are going outside into nature and enjoying themselves. So we really need to appreciate them and listen to them. Why are they here? What do they want to see? What do they want to do? Not everyone has the same experiences. You know, they might not have been privileged enough like me to have parents who are constantly taking them out into nature. They might not have the money to afford nice hiking boots. That doesn't matter. We can still find some amazing things for them to do.
Right, don't matter.
Exactly. It's tough after 3 million people, but it's important that we remember every single person is different. That's definitely one of the hardest parts.
Right. Do you feel your education probably makes a difference?
I hope so. I really do hope so. I think at least there is some support. It's not just about educating, but about also making a connection, especially like emotionally. The more that we can get people to have an emotional connection, just like sort of how we can eat a special type of food and have a memory of a really good time that we had that maybe with friends or family. The same thing works for nature. We can learn about nature and we can also build memories. And it's actually proven that when people have memories or connections or have a specific emotion regarding a plant or an animal or a place, they are more than likely to be an advocate for those things. So if I have a special memory with a deer, not maybe a specific one, but deer in general, I'm more likely to help in my community with maybe teaching others about deer or building areas where that deer or those deer can live. So I hope by just making people have good memories of visiting that in the future, they will have that personal connection that can make a difference in how they act. That's really the goal of it all, I think.
Right. You are. What is your personal way of connecting people with nature when you are teaching?
I just encourage people to see the nature in their own lives, because a lot of people come and visit here in Joshua Tree and go, wow, this is a really cool area to visit. And I don't blame them. It's a hard place to live, especially during the summer where it gets about 115 degrees during the day. It's a cool place to visit. But the most important part is realizing that when they go home or when they are at their house, nature is still all around them and it still provides a lot for them. I don't want them to feel like they're disconnected from it once they leave a national park. They can also find what they love about it. Again, I like hiking and sitting outside and watching birds, but they might have different things. It might be an inspiration for them to draw or to create art, or it might be something that they can get outside and get physical activity in. But everyone has their own way, and I want them to discover that. That's really my way of teaching about nature.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Great questions.
My name is Elvis. My first question is, what are the many dangers of not protecting our environment?
That's a really, really good question, too. So the few big things I think of is nature and wildlife have a bunch of different values or a bunch of different ways that they help us, right? They give us food. We grow crops. We have agriculture that gives us pretty much a lot of what we have on our tables every day or what we go and get at restaurants. It actually also is a great way that we find medicine. It's a great way that we can give money to our communities. A lot of places, towns, or cities benefit from having nature because all the people who have money will travel to those areas just to see it, bringing money to like the stores, restaurants, and businesses we have. So if we do not protect the environment, we lose our sources of food. We lose the potential to find brand new medicines. In fact, I believe below 5% of all the different wildlife on the planet has actually been studied for what it can do as a medicine for us. Different mushrooms can teach us how to break down plastics so that we don't have plastics on our planet for the rest of our lives. And the most important value to me is just the idea of nature has the right to exist. It exists for its own sake, right? You know, we can ascribe a value to it, but it just like we deserve our rights as people, nature deserves rights too. And the more that we take away those rights, we're at danger of then what's next? Whose rights come next as being not as important in the world anymore?
That's good. And my other question is, from your own field, what other careers are around that field?
Of course. So on my side, I work in education. So like a teacher, but outside, you can do a ton of things. Many people think, oh, you can only teach about nature out in the middle of nowhere. But, you know, you can do it at museums like the Field Museum or the Nature Museum, the Peggy Notbart. You could do it at parks. You know, any local park has a bunch of teachers who take care of kids in the summer and teach them about plants and animals. Nature centers or even schools, you know, there's plenty of opportunities to teach about nature that doesn't depend on being in the middle of nowhere where you have to drive really far or hike really far to see it. But on the other side, there is a lot of jobs that focus on the wildlife or the science part of it. So you can either like teach about it or you can research it. So there are wildlife scientists, those who want to know, why do animals do this? Or why is this plant this way? Or what is happening? Why is this changing? That's a really important thing that can be done all over the world. And that sort of leads to another type of job that we call like a wildlife manager, someone who actually is out there. They're working in the field, like maybe digging up invasive plants or helping plant new ones or making plans to help other animals survive better. We actually had some really awesome horticulturists, so people who work with plants at the Garfield Park Conservatory. Think of them like zookeepers, but for plants. They would spend all their day caring for all the different plants that the conservatory had so that other people could come and visit them.
What sorts of endangered species have you encouraged?
Encountered. Yeah, I would say the two ones that I think of the most are going to be the desert tortoise, the one that we have here at Joshua Tree. They are endangered because, well, they really depend on being able to move sometimes pretty large distances. You know, we think of like the tortoise being so slow, and that's actually a big problem because humans like us, we like to move fast. We build these really big roads to help us get through the desert. And tortoise are really, really slow at crossing those. I once had to stop while driving through Joshua Tree National Park for a little desert tortoise that wasn't much bigger than maybe an inch or two. I was like, okay, I'm going to wait and make sure that this one is able to get across the road. It took 25 minutes for that little tortoise to cross the road. And that's a big reason why it's endangered. Tortoise do not fare well against a car. But I also got to say, my other favorite endangered species that I got to work with were the African penguins at Lincoln Park Zoo. They are suffering because of loss of habitat and areas that they can create burrows, and lack of food because a lot of humans are fishing for the same type of fish that they are eating. They're doing a lot of good work at Lincoln Park Zoo to help get research or restoration or work done in the environments where African penguins live, but also just to help people learn about them at the zoo. Something I would definitely check out if you're in Chicago.
Yeah, that is true. Like St. Kitts, but the plants, animals. Also, there's like food, like in the nature, like acorns, plants, I think carrots.
Yep.
And sort of stuff. I have a question. How does nature can help with people that have, like, for example, let's say that one person got anxious, depression, frustrated, like all kind of stuff.
Yes.
Does nature help that?
Nature does. It really does, because it can teach us about how to work with our thoughts. It sounds a bit scary, but when we're alone with our thoughts, it can sometimes be intimidating, but nature and being out in nature can encourage us to take the time to think about our problems. And they might be something that's just in your head that you really want to find a solution for. Or it might be something that is not right in the world, something that an injustice that's upon us, or someone that might not be treating us right. Getting time to think about that when you're outdoors, because outdoors really helps to clear all the other things around us. I know we've probably all tried to do something, like sit down and do a task, but there's so many other things that are going on that it's hard to concentrate. Nature helps us concentrate when we can get out into nature for just even, you don't have to necessarily go for a long hike. You can just go out on a area that has a tree and sit next to it, sit under its shade and just think. Nature provides an area for us to think. I know as someone who went through therapy for really bad anxiety and depression, having time to think and change the bad thoughts that I'm having into good thoughts is really important, but we don't always get that. And nature is a good way to get that time.
Yeah, I will actually try naturing. Since I want my goal there.
Yeah.
So I can like calm myself and relax, because right now, in my case, I still have anxious and compulsive. So I would like give it a try, like to see nature. And what were you saying about the shadow? Like I had to see in the shadow?
Yeah, like sometimes for me, one of the best things is to just, if there's not like a big green space that you can easily get to, sometimes it's just nice on a sunny day to sit under the shade or shadow of a tree.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's a great one. Oh, nothing's better than a good, sounds nerdy, but a good tree.
Oh, okay. So I'll actually give it a try.
Yeah, I would definitely encourage it.
Thank you.
Of course, you're very welcome.
Hello, Ian. My name is Justice, and I'm wondering, have you ever encountered hybrids, animals, and plants?
Ooh. So, there is not too many, although we are starting to see them in different areas. One that I have encountered, although it's not something people think of when they think of hybrid animals and plants, is something we call a pocket mouse. It is a really, really, really tiny mouse that cannot travel very far. So it actually has started, instead of changing itself or trying to move as its environment change, is actually now starting to breed or mate with other types of mice. So now we have all these weird hybrid types of mouse or mice living all over the desert here. And some are better at living in certain areas, or some have special adaptations for areas with more or less water. It's a very interesting one. Otherwise, we're starting to see it in plants out here too, as the desert changes. It's actually getting hotter, which just sounds so great. I love really hot weather, but oh God. Now the plants are getting better at using less water or even getting hotter and hotter and surviving sometimes temperatures up into the 130 degrees. I am not a big fan of that temperature.
Me
I will
either.
Stay inside that. Oh yeah, right? I'll stay inside those times.
Yeah, I like high breeze. It's weird, but I like them.
Yeah. It's interesting because they represent how animals and plants change. As the environment changes, animals and plants have to change with it in order to survive. And hybrids are an example of how that has happened. It's really, really cool. It's science in the works.
Science can work in strange different ways.
Oh, yeah. That's a good point.
Thank you, Ian.
You're very welcome. Great question.
Who inspired you to do nature?
Who inspired me? A big one was my grandpa. This was my step-grandpa. He was pretty poor growing up in rural Wisconsin, and he learned about nature in a different way. Most teachers told him that the way he learned about nature through like fishing and hunting was not the right way. He needed to be a scientist and focus on being really science-minded. And he didn't listen to that. He went into wildlife management and ended up teaching as a biology teacher and a principal in a high school. But he inspired me to change the way I think about it as not only being one way to learn about and experience nature. He was just a part of nature. And he really inspired me to see myself the same way. But I also can't get away without thanking some of my amazing teachers I had. I went to the University of Illinois Chicago for a master's degree and had some amazing professors who taught me to enjoy nature and science in a way that I never thought I could.
How you going to do good going forward?
Well, for me, the best good that I can do going forward is to include more people. Nature's hard to get to. It's not always accessible for every type of person. People in certain areas of the country have no access to it or don't have the money or the opportunities available to them, or they think that jobs like a park ranger are never going to be possible for them. And the good that I want to do is to change the way that we bring nature to others, help them realize that they can do these things. They can be a park ranger if they want to. Nature right now can sometimes feel like it leaves people out. And that's not how it's supposed to be. It's supposed to be for everyone, no matter if you live in a big city or in the middle of the country or in a rural area. It is for everyone. And to do good is to help people recognize that and change the way that education or nature works, at least at the human level, to bring it to all of those different people.
What advice do you have for someone who lives in the city to connect with nature?
At least in Chicago, big ones I think of are the Chicago Parks District and the Cook County Forest Preserves. All over Cook County and Chicago are trying to get opportunities available. And this means getting buses and helping with set up field trips to areas where students or people excited about nature can find ways to get out there and learn. I really like the North Park Village Nature Center. And the big one is about making things free and accessible so that anyone can show up at any time during that event and learn. Sometimes it's about having buses or having ways for people to get there, because not everyone can have a car that can drive hours away to go to a national park or to a state park. So calling different areas that people are interested in, like maybe going to the zoo or going to a park, calling and asking, "Hi, I really want to try and visit, but I'm not sure how to get there." A lot of these places are now offering ways that they can help get you there. Another one I do have to add is, I know we've probably all been somewhere where it feels like, wow, I'm the only one here who looks or acts or is like me, and I don't feel comfortable. You know, I don't feel like I belong here. And we're trying to change that. We're trying to change this and be like, you can experience this area and enjoy it the way you want to enjoy it. Just because you might look different or feel different doesn't mean that it's not for you. You know, that's another barrier. It's this sort of mental barrier that is all over because people feel like they aren't welcome. And we want to bring them to our parks and bring them to these beautiful areas with nature, but also make them feel welcome. So if you ever go somewhere to an event like a special field trip or a time where you get to go help work on some of the landscape and help with the trees and plants, talk to the people who work there because they want you to be there. And I'm sure that you can find some really awesome people who will share other ways that you can belong there and help. I have two things that are really important for my Chicago friends out there who I don't miss the weather, but I miss living in Chicago, that's for sure. You all have a brand new national park right by you. The Indiana Dunes, which is just outside Gary, Indiana. So maybe I would say about an hour to hour and a half drive from Chicago is now a national park. It is awesome. It's going to be a really cool thing for the Midwest, especially right by Chicago. It's a beautiful area with big sand dunes and you can swim there. And it even has, you can see the Chicago skyline from the beaches sometimes, depending on how nice the day is. You all are now the brand new neighbors to a national park. And if any of you also have little brothers or little sisters or cousins, the national parks do something really cool called Every Kid in a Park. And you can simply quickly go online and any kid who is in fourth grade can get a free pass that works for any national park or land that's owned by the federal government. So for those who have little siblings, go look into that. You know, it might be a way to possibly make a vacation to somewhere out in nature a little cheaper or something more affordable for someone who has a young sibling or cousin or something like that. Sorry, those are my shameless plugs for things with the National Park Service.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, great questions.
You're welcome.
Oh, man. Thank you so much. Y'all were amazing to talk to. It's really fun to get to talk about these kind of things. I hope Chicago weather is treating y'all great, and have a great one.
All right. So let's give a hand for Ian. Well, I'm going to start a podcast. It's produced by students at the Red Ground Training Center High School in Chicago.
With the production support from Actors School Manners and the Creating Imposter Studios.
Our theme music is by Gennaro Jackson, aka DJ Spark.
Follow Patty's Story, Facebook, Instagram,
Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Pandora, and Spotify.
Our website is poweryourstorypodcast.com.
Thank you for listening.
And have a great day.